Morning. Stand with me this morning. That's so quiet. Good morning. We came ready to worship Jesus this morning. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Father, we have come into this room. We've gathered some online this morning, Lord, that we can come and worship and praise the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Jesus, we just invite your presence into this room today. We ask that you would be lifted up and exalted in all that's said and done. Lord, we want to celebrate your goodness and your mercy and your blessings. We ask it, stay with me, church, in Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, let's put our hands together. Let's lift up our voices. Let's raise our hands. Let's worship Jesus today. Thank you.
morning. Lift your hands up to him. Lift your voices to him. He is holy and he is worthy. Father, we praise you, Jesus. We love you, Lord. We lift our voices to you, God. Lord, not because of anything that we've done, Lord, but because of who you are, Lord. We praise you, Jesus. You are here. Starts with our heart, church. Praise starts with a surrendered heart. Just tell him you surrender. Say, Jesus, you can have it all, Lord. You can have every part, Jesus. I surrender, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy to take time. Church, Lord, rule on my street where I live, oh God. Thank you for the sacrifice that you made, Jesus, so we could be free. Just start thanking the Lord. Start thanking the Lord. Say, thank you, Jesus. Remind me of what you brought me from, Jesus. Remind me of the things that you set me free from, Jesus. There's none like you, Jesus. Thank you.
Come on, sing it with me today, will you, church?
Oh, the wonderful cross. Oh, the wonderful cross. All who gather here by grace draw near and bless your name.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise team, I'm going to go into communion now. So if you just continue to play, I'm going to go into communion. Thank you, Jesus. If you grab your elements that were passed out earlier, I was going to do this at the end of the service today, but I think I'm going to do it now. Jesus.
See from his head, his hands, his feet, sorrow and love flowing cool down. Did e'er such love and sorrow meet, or thorns compose so rich a crown? Oh, the wonderful cross. Oh, the come and die and find that I may truly live. Oh, the wonderful cross. Oh, the wonderful cross. All who gather here by grace draw near and bless your name.
On the same night that Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread and he broke it and he said, "This is my body which is broken for you. As often as you do eat this bread, you do show forth my death." Let's take a moment right now and first let's examine our hearts. The Bible calls us to do that. If there's anything inside that we need to make right with Jesus, this is the time to just surrender that thing to the Lord. If there's a relationship that we need to make right with Jesus, this is the time to, at least within our hearts, begin making amends and forgiveness in our heart. Jesus paid it all when he gave up his flesh on the cross. He paid a price he didn't have to pay. He made a sacrifice he didn't have to make. He showed extravagant love to you and I when he went to that cross and became the sacrifice for sin for all of time, for all of mankind. We owe our eternity to Jesus. Lord, we thank you for the bread that we hold in our hands. We thank you for the sacrifice that you made. We thank you that, Lord, you became flesh and you dwelt amongst us, and then you offered that same flesh as an offering, as payment for our sin. We claim today, Lord, because it says that by your stripes we are healed. And I pray for those that, Lord, who might be sick in their bodies today. You took stripes upon your back, Lord. You took the wounds and the nails, Lord, for even not only for our spiritual man to be healed, but for our physical man to experience healing. And today I pray, God, that whether someone is online today, Lord, I lift up Andres, Lord, who's in his last few rounds of another sessions of chemo, that God, you would touch the cancer in his body, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for how you sustained him and touched him. Pray that you'd continue to work healing, Father, for Sue, who's with us today, but Lord, has been struggling still physically in her body. Lord, for others that are recovering from surgeries, Lord, or going through different illnesses, Lord, there's healing. There's healing through your sacrifice. So we thank you that you gave your body so we could be made whole. Let's partake of the bread together. Thank you, Jesus. And they took the cup. He said, this is the blood of a new testament. As often as you do drink this cup, you do show forth my death. The blood of Jesus, church. Year after year, Israelites had to bring thousands upon thousands upon thousands of lambs every Passover to be sacrificed to remember that Christ, or to remember that God had passed over with the angel of death in Egypt to preserve their life and the life of those in their home. Jesus became that Passover lamb to give us not just life passed over once, but that death wouldn't pass over once, but it'd be permanent, that we would eternally live with him because of his blood. Jesus, we thank you for the cup. We thank you for your sacrifice. Lord, we thank you for the blood that causes death to pass over us in its eternity, that we might have eternal life and have a hope, Lord, that our spirit man will never die. And Lord, even then, that one day our physical man might be raised to newness of life, united with that spirit man, for those who have died before you have returned for your church. We thank you. None of this is possible except through the blood of Jesus. We thank you for your grace and your mercy and your love. Let's partake of the cup together. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, come on, let's just praise him. Thank you, Jesus. Thank him right now for the blood. Thank him right now for the body. Thank him right now for the cross. See from his head, his hands, his feet, sorrow and love flow. Such love and sorrow meet, or thorns compose so rich a crown. Oh, the wonderful cross, oh, the come and die and find that I may truly live. Oh, the wonderful cross, oh, the wonderful cross, all who gather here by grace draw near and bless your name. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, today we thank you for your blood and your body that was offered for us. Just say it. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for that sacrifice. Thank you, Jesus. We love you, Lord. Lord, we ask this in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. Amen. You may be seated. Praise the Lord.
It's April 3rd, and welcome to Destiny Church. We're glad that you came to join with us today as we begin the focus on the Easter season. If you're here for the first time, would you do us a favor and just take the Connect card that was in your bulletin, fill out the blue side of that, and drop it in the box in the foyer. If you give us your complete address, we want to send you a little something just to say thanks for coming out and trying Destiny Church this morning. Like every Sunday, at the conclusion of our service in the foyer, the greeters will be there to receive tithes and offerings as you're exiting the church today. We want to thank those of you who have been taking on our 90-day challenge, as well as our faithful givers. It's making a difference. Keep on trusting Jesus, and we're believing for his great blessings in your life. Now, if you want to give online, www.yourdestinychurch.org, that's www.yourdestinychurch.org, is an easy way to online give or even set up a weekly or monthly payment option. We also want to let you know if you want to mail in that tithe and offering, you can send it to Destiny Church, P.O. Box 144, Fort Lupton, Colorado, 80621. This week at Destiny, we're going to be continuing on with our different D groups. James Jones is going to continue on in his study on the book of 1 Peter. I'll be continuing my leadership class with the deacons up in my office. Kim Kuzner is going to continue on with the spying series with our children. And Ozzy and Liz are continuing on with the Jesus-centered life with our youth. You know, it's never too late to jump in and be a part of Wednesday night's study of the Word of God. And if you were listening last week to our message, it's a good thing to get into God's Word in a deeper way. So join us this Wednesday at 7 p.m. Now also, we want to remind you that Easter is coming up in just 2 weeks on April 17th. We have a great morning plan for everybody. There's going to be a He Is Risen photo booth. There's going to be Easter games, an Easter breakfast, and of course our Easter celebration service. It all begins at 8:30 with our service beginning at 10. Now, Kim Kuzner would like to know if you're willing to help bring in some plastic eggs and wrapped candy that can fit inside of eggs. We're doing that for our Easter egg hunt and our Easter egg games. Just drop them off to Kim next Sunday morning. We also want to let you know that Judy McGill is rounding up some volunteers to help prepare the food for Easter breakfast. If you're willing to make a casserole, fresh fruit, or a baked item, please contact Judy as soon as possible. She's the lady behind the donut bar. We're looking forward to that Easter Sunday morning celebration, as it's one of our most dynamic days of the year here at Destiny. Now, prepare your hearts as I begin my first message in an Easter focus series. And this week, we're going to be talking about Jesus being anointed for burial.
I want to just let you know that if you want to be a part of that team that's going to be going out, it's not going to be a massive time commitment monthly, but if you want to be a part of that team that goes out and welcomes newcomers into our community, I've heard of a couple people have told other people I'm going to be a part of that, but they haven't told me, so I need to know. So please fill out on your Connect card, drop it in the box on your way out today. Today's kind of the last day. I need to know that I've got at least a team of five or six who are going to be a part of that, so we can go forward with that plan. I'm making plans to meet with the mayor soon and some different things so we can kind of try start getting that ministry off and rolling. We'd love to have you be a part of it and what's going on with that. So I want to encourage you for that invite team to just go and welcome newcomers in our community. It's like as simple as going, showing up someone's door saying, hey, welcome to Fort Lupton. We're from Destiny Church. These are some gifts from our local community. We want to just say welcome to our community. Can we pray with you about anything? And if not, that's okay. Don't go into their house. Leave. I mean, you know, it can be a whole of 3-5 minutes, you know what I'm saying? So just want to encourage, we need some people to help with that though, amen? Amen. Don't forget all those good Easter plans, including Good Friday. And so Good Friday communion, it'll just be 1 hour. You come Anytime during that hour, you and your family, and I'll just serve you communion between 5 and 6. And those of you who have taken advantage of that in the past, it's a great time on Good Friday to remember what the Lord's done. It's not a formal service. It's just coming in and just taking a time of remembrance on that day between 5 and 6 on Good Friday. So make plans for that. All right, ready for the word? You live today? Nice to see a little fuller crowd out there this morning. Spring break is over. And spring is kind of here. Isn't that nice? Who's enjoying a little bit of green grass that's starting to show up out there? Got daffodils popping up in my front yard. I love it. No more snow, hopefully. Doubtfully, but you know, it's Colorado. We know that that's from Mother's Day, so amen. Anointed for burial. I want to begin focusing for the next couple of weeks as we're just, can you believe Easter is actually just 2 weeks from today? But I want to start focusing on some things that happened during the week of Easter. You know, we've all heard probably before, if you've gone to church for any amount of time, we've heard that Jesus is the Passover lamb, that Christ is the Passover lamb. And the Passover lamb was in the Old Testament. We know that the Jews still celebrate today with their Seder suppers, that the Passover lamb represented that lamb that was sacrificed when the Israelites were in Egypt. And you know, it's interesting. God has a sense of humor. Who believes God has a sense of humor? God, when he told them to take a lamb and sacrifice it for the angel of death to pass over, not just take a lamb, but literally take a lamb into their house for like a 4 to 5 day window to examine it for fault and make it their own. It was like, it was asking his people to make this commitment to sacrifice the deities of Egypt. The Egyptians literally worshipped sheep and goats. They had deities that were sheep and goats. For them to take a lamb was like, it was almost like God saying, in your face, Egypt. And they had this thing, and we know that when that lamb was killed and the blood was put over the doorpost, that when that 10th plague came, that the angel of death passed over. And through the years, that was an Old Testament, really a prophetic act, where they were delivered out of Egypt and delivered through and eventually made it to the promised land. But it was there to point the way to who Jesus would do for us in regard to sin. That when he was sacrificed, his blood would be applied to our hearts, that death would no longer have a hold over those who had that blood applied to their lives through faith. I want us to begin looking at Christ, the Lamb of God. John the Baptist said when he was baptizing people, and he said, there's one that's going to come before me. He's going to baptize you with the fire and the Holy Ghost. And when Jesus showed up on the scene, John actually declares the words, "Behold the Lamb of God." And I don't know if we know all the intricacies sometimes that take place during that last week, that week preceding the Passover where Christ was crucified. But as Christians, it's so important for us to get a focus on this important thing this time of year, to remember it all throughout the year, but especially during the season, because this is the season that we remember the greatest mission that Jesus came for, to save you and I. We just celebrated that in communion. We celebrated the cross. We celebrated his death and his resurrection and the life he gives through his blood. And I want to begin this morning by talking about the Lamb that is chosen. The Lamb that is chosen. Because we're going to look at two passages of Scripture, and it's all in that. I don't know if we've always looked at these passages of Scripture, if we always have put together the truths that are in these pictures or these two accounts that we're going to talk about, but it was really all about Jesus becoming the chosen Lamb in these two events. And that's the stories of when Christ had, do you remember the stories of the woman who came and washed Jesus' hair with her feet? Well, there are four accounts that get put together in Scripture. There are four different places in Scripture where that shows up. Luke chapter 7, which has nothing to do with the other three accounts. In Luke chapter 7, it's at the beginning of Jesus' ministry. A woman comes and washes his feet with her tears and dries his feet, and she uses water, but she washes his feet. She was a prostitute. It's a totally different account than the two things or the two times that happen that we see recorded in Matthew 26, Mark 14, and John chapter 12. Now, those other three accounts
Many have actually put together and made tried to make them into one account, but they're not. They're two. They're two different occurrences. Two different occurrences where in one, Mary, the sister of Lazarus, y'all remember Lazarus who was raised from the dead? Not long after that event where he had been raised from the dead, just less than 1 week, 6 days before Passover, John 12 records the event where Mary comes and breaks open a jar of alabaster oil and washes the feet of Jesus with that oil, rubs that oil on his feet, the whole spikenard, all of it wasted upon him, a very expensive thing, and wipes it with her hair. Not the same as the one in Luke 7. It's his own account. But people often, this was at her own house, the house of her brother Lazarus, but people have often, because of so many similarities, mixed that account with the account in Matthew 26 and Mark 14, which are identical accounts, it's the same situation, where an unnamed woman, 2 days before Passover, not 6 days before Passover, in the same community of Bethany, comes and anoints Jesus' head, not feet, with oil in the house of Simon the leper. For many years, people have tried to say Lazarus was actually also called Simon and he must have had leprosy. Or people have tried to find ways to relate how those were the same event. But many others have never agreed with that situation. But if you understand the significance of why there were two times Jesus was anointed with oil prior to his crucifixion, then we come to understand why it's two different situations. And so we're going to look at that this morning. Would you open up your Bibles to, I'm going to start with John 12. I have them in mixed order, William. I'm going to read John 12 first because this is in chronological order. It happened first. John 12 verses, are you there? Y'all alive, right? I gave you a little depth this morning, so. 6 days before the Passover celebration began, Jesus arrived in Bethany, the home of Lazarus, the man he had raised from the dead. A dinner was prepared in Jesus' honor. Martha served, and Lazarus was among those who ate with him. Then Mary took a 12-ounce jar of expensive perfume made from essence of nard. Just so you know, nard could have been lavender or lemongrass, but you might look at it as a big, whopping, expensive jar of essential oils these days. And she anointed Jesus' feet with it, wiping his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the fragrance. But Judas Iscariot, the disciple who would soon betray him, said that perfume was worth a year's wages. In other words, it would take a common person a year to save up that much money. So think of it in our day of maybe $36,000. 12-ounce jar of oil. It was worth a year's wages. It should have been sold and the money given to the poor. Not that he cared for the poor. He was a thief. And since he was in charge of the disciples' money, he often stole some for himself. This is Judas. Jesus replied, "Leave her alone. She did this in preparation for my burial. You will always have the poor among you, but you will not always have me." Let's go to Mark chapter 14 in verses 1 to 10. That's the account 6 days before Passover where she anoints Jesus' feet, Mary, in her brother Lazarus' house 6 days before. Now, 2 days before, says it was now 2 days before Passover and the festival of unleavened bread. There are two festivals that went on at the same time. The leading priests and the teachers of religious law were still looking for an opportunity to capture Jesus secretly and kill him, but not during the Passover celebration. This is how we know we are in the midst of the Passover season, where the other was at the very beginning. But not during the Passover celebration, they agreed, or the people may riot. Meanwhile, Jesus was in Bethany at the home of Simon. Just so you know, Bethany was like kind of like the suburb of Jerusalem, so it would be a little less expensive and common for people to go in and out of the city and maybe stay in Bethany because the city would be so filled with people that it would be very hard for Jerusalem to hold them all. And he was in Bethany at the home of Simon, a man who had previously had leprosy. Well, probably one that Jesus healed. And while he was eating, a woman, no name, in either Matthew 26 or Matthew 14 or Mark 14, a woman came in with a beautiful alabaster jar of expensive perfume made from essence of nard. Same stuff, same type of stuff. She broke open the jar and poured the perfume over his head. Some of those at the table were indignant. And we know that the indignant ones were actually disciples. Jesus' friends, stirred by Judas. Why waste such expensive perfume, they asked. It could have been sold for a year's wages and the money given to the poor. Again, the same situation is occurring. Someone has brought and extravagantly poured out an expensive perfume or oil upon Jesus. Not once, but now a second time in the same week. But Jesus replied, "Leave her alone. Why criticize her for doing such a good thing to me? You will always have the poor among you, and you can help them whenever you want to, but you will not always have me. She has done what she could and has anointed my body for burial ahead of time. I tell you the truth, wherever the good news is preached throughout the world, this woman's deed will be remembered and discussed." Well, if I look at my watch and calendar, we're about 2,000 years later and we're still talking about it. Then Judas Iscariot, one of the 12 disciples, went to the leading priest to arrange to betray Jesus to them. In other words, once was bad enough, but twice I'm going to go and get something for myself. Let's talk about this. The first thing I want to talk about this morning is that the Passover lamb is chosen. Let's focus on Jesus for just a moment this morning. He is the Lamb of God that John the Baptist called out. He would be the Lamb of God that would take away all of our sins. Before these events, both of these events, Jesus had already had some time where he was with his disciples and he said, "We're getting ready to go to Jerusalem. And when we get there, I'm going to be taken and I'm going to be killed and crucified and I'm going to be put to death, but I will rise again." He had already begun to explain to his disciples that his death was imminent and what was going to happen. I'm not sure if his disciples really believed what was coming ahead, or they didn't want to believe. For sure, Judas didn't. Judas was following Jesus, hoping that he was going to become a Messiah, a political ruler, a political one that would overtake the Roman armies and bring freedom, and he was hoping to gain wealth from his commitment and identification with Christ. But these female followers, this woman that Matthew 26 and Mark 14 talk about, as well as Mary, the sister of Lazarus, both of them with love for who Jesus was and probably a gratitude in their heart, realizing that death was coming upon him, wanted to do something to honor him, wanted to do something to show their great love for him. I'm not sure if they would really even understand what they were doing and the spiritual significance in fulfilling God's plan really was. Because it wasn't just a happenstance that these two women anointed him, one his feet and one his head. Because you see, something that was common in the day that we don't, it's not written in the law, but how many of you know that sometimes when there's holiday celebrations or things that, you know, we have what you're supposed to do, and then things that become tradition around it. Y'all understand that? You know, you have your traditions. Like maybe there's a specific date. Like some people I know who are more practicing Catholics, there's a certain day that you're supposed to put your tree up and take it down after the wise men came, and traditions that kind of come into our world. Well, in the Hebrew tradition, they understood that according to the Passover, the celebration of Passover, on the fifth day before Passover, or 4 days before Passover, you have this whole thing because the Jewish day starts at sunset the day before and goes to sunset the next day. It's different from our days where we just kind of have it in the middle. But on the 10th day of the month of Nisan is when they were to bring a lamb into their house and keep it there for 4 days of evaluation, 5 days before it would be crucified. Sorry, before it would be killed. Jesus was crucified. And that would be a day that actually marks the triumphal entry of Christ coming into the city, representative of how the Passover lamb comes into the house. But of course, if you're going to bring a lamb into the house, you got to go out to the field and get the lamb. The lamb had to be 1 year old, couldn't be any older, couldn't be younger, needed to be a yearling. And it had to be without a blemish. So the day before, kind of like, you know, we go out and get our Christmas trees a couple weeks before. It used to always be on Christmas Eve. Now it's like, you know, on Halloween. And I don't know about some people. It's like, it's September, let's put up the tree. Like, seriously. But they would go out on the sixth day before, they would go out and choose their lamb. Now, you know, the lamb was up like usually in pastures and hills that were rocky and craggy. And you know what happens, you know, maybe you understand this if you ever take your dog hiking in the mountains and stuff like that. What can happen to an animal who's walking through rough terrain? Their feet can get beat up or bruised or scratched. You can put a blemish on them. Well, the lamb is supposed to be unblemished. So they would go out and pick a perfect lamb, and then they would have to take that lamb, and they're not going to carry that lamb, it kind of weighs a lot, back to their house. They're going to walk that lamb back to their house. But they've already inspected its legs and its ankles and its feet, and so in order to keep it from getting harmed, there was this one thing often used by shepherds. We've talked about this before in other times of the year, and that was oil. We talked about how they would put oil on the sheep's head when it had to graze in the ground so the snakes couldn't bite it, and how they'd use it to bring healing to wounds on the thing. They'd also use oil to prevent it from getting cut. So in order to prevent blemishes from coming, because you don't want to choose a Passover lamb and have it get blemished on its way home, because then you got to go do it all over again, they would rub oil all over its feet and its ankles and its legs because they had chosen that lamb to be used. You see the similarity? So when Mary came and took this expensive bottle of spikenard, oil with the essence of nard in it, again, probably lavender or lemongrass or a mix of the two, she was symbolically showing Jesus as the chosen lamb for the Passover. Her anointing that, and you know, the issue was that it was customary if you had an honored guest, and it says in John that he was the honored guest. It would be customary for the honored guest to have his feet washed, but they would take water and they would put a drop or two of a perfume or an ointment into that water to scent the water. All you needed is a drop or two. Think of all of those of you who diffuse nonstop, you know? It's like, just takes a couple of drops to fuse for hours. She didn't do that. She broke it open and she poured the actual straight oil on his feet. Now, you have to understand, the Torah, which is the law that the Hebrews followed, had laws against excess in celebration. And for someone to take and pour out a year's worth of wages, perfume, not sparingly, which could take you years to use up, but all of it at once would be considered excess, great excess. However, Jesus understood one truth. Excess for celebration was limited, but excess for mourning was permitted. If you were grieving someone who was going to be, if you were grieving, it was different. When someone's body was being anointed for burial to keep the body from, in its decay, from stinking during the grieving process, they would use things like this to pour all over the body. In fact, when the women were going to the tomb the day that Jesus rose from the dead, they were bringing such a substance to anoint his body, but Jesus never had his body anointed at his death because he rose from the dead before they had an opportunity to bring it to him. And that's why I said, she's doing this in preparation for my burial. In other words, your whole argument about waste doesn't hold up. And he's talking this one about the one who anoints his head, about the waste. Both of them have an argument about sell it and give it to the poor. But it was the account in Mark 14 that the actual term waste was used. Now, after that lamb was chosen and brought into the house, there was an expectation. What happens when you bring a little fuzzy thing into your house? Don't you start to love that little fuzzy thing? Don't you get attached to it? You know, a one-year-old lamb is just innocent and sweet and cuddly and kind of loving. They haven't grown up to be kind of an ornery sheep yet. They're just kind of like, all like that. Why do you think God chose a lamb as an example? Because of its innocence. And they were brought into the house over those next 4 days. they could be examined to make sure that there was no imperfection, that there wasn't a limp or a spot that wasn't detected or something wasn't missed. So that at the end of that, those 4 days of examination, before it would be offered to be offered up as a sacrifice on the fifth day, or the 14th day of Nisan, that it would be found without fault. And we're going to talk about that next week when we talk about Pilate and his words. But on that fourth day, 2 days before Passover, when is the account of the woman who anointed Jesus' head? 2 days before. On that day, oil was put on the head of the sheep to show, or the lamb, to show, you've passed the test. You've been found without fault. Now, between that sixth day and that before Passover, and the 2 days before Passover, during that time of Jesus had met up with Pharisees and Sadducees, had been asked all kinds of questions. They were trying to find all kinds of fault with him to try and get him arrested, to try and trick him in some way so that way he would be taken away. But you know what? They couldn't find a fault in him. And yet on that second day, another woman comes along, this one not named, and she takes another bottle of perfume and breaks it and pours the entire bottle, worth, again, maybe like around $36,000 to $40,000 in our currency today, over his head, because he's been approved to be that lamb. And in these two moments of anointing Jesus with this oil, there's tremendous significance, because it shows us that not only to the according to the law, but even according to the traditions of the day, this would be common knowledge to any Hebrew, that his feet on the sixth day before and his head on 2 days before had been anointed for him to be the sacrifice, had been prepared for his burial. You know, church, sometimes people question, well, was Jesus really the Messiah? Really, what was that sacrifice all about? We've come so far, so many years from that period of history and time that sometimes I think because we become so familiar with the stories of the church, so much where we're almost becoming being past familiar with the stories of what are in the Word of God, that we almost don't see the intricacy of the details that are there. But Jesus was that chosen Lamb of God. And these two women, this brings me to my second thought this morning, these two women brought him a sacrificial love that would be honored throughout all of history. Jesus honored the sacrificial love that they would show him. The disciples were indignant, especially Judas. Judas was, he followed Jesus for 3 years. He held the money. He used to sneak money. He used to steal from the bags of money that the disciples had that paid their expenses as they went along the way and everything that they did. And he just saw this as, this is my opportunity. You could have sold that and we could have given money to the poor. He would have gone to give the money to the poor and he would have kept about 30% back for himself. And he saw that as a means that he could have stolen from the Lord. But that's not what he hid it behind. Of course, he hid it behind, we could have given this to the poor. But there's an indignancy, and we'll talk about that in a moment, that came out. And Jesus is honored because he realizes, he understands, he knows all that's happening. He knows the plan of the Father. He knows he's about to die. And he sees this woman pour out extravagant love upon him. This expensive heirloom, not once, but twice. Two different women have come and poured out these expensive oils upon him. And honored him in such depth and such way. You know, we can, just like people can say, well, you know, the law says that's an excessive waste and we shouldn't do that. I see people, sometimes people make great sacrifices for the kingdom of God. They make great sacrifices for Jesus Christ with their love, and they show great things to him. No monetary thing is going to even hold them back, because they want to show the Lord, Lord, I love you just this much. And in our selfish society, we look at those people and say, foolish person, that was wasteful. Is there anything too extravagant to be spent on the Lord? Is there anything too extravagant to be given to him to be poured out in love before him. And what about our own lives? What about our own lives? Steve Green, if you're a little older like I am, wrote a song or sang a song years ago about being broken and spilled out. And it was talking about this event where this valuable essence was broken and spilled out over him, and how the fragrance filled the room. To this woman, to Jesus, that was a fragrance of life. It was a fragrance of sacrificial love. It was, Jesus was about to make the greatest sacrifice for each of those ladies, and they wanted to pour their love out to the Lord as great as they could. In the song that Steve Green sang, though, years ago, he ties it all together, the sacrifice of Christ, the sacrifice of these women, and then at the end, in the last words, he says, Lord, you were spilled out and used up for me. Let me be spilled out and used up for you. Is it too much of God to look at our lives and say, will you be used up and spilled out for me? And I say that in regard to, you know, we have come to such a place in the church where it's hard to get to church once a week anymore. It's hard to come and worship the Lord. It's hard. We don't have time to find places of serving Jesus, of doing something back for the Lord or giving to God. We don't find places of serving in his kingdom. Oh yeah, we got Jesus in our lives, but as far as giving back to Jesus, I mean, we even talked about that in the whole tithing thing a few weeks back about not loving money more than God. Is there anything too extravagant to come and lay at the feet of Christ? To pour over his head? Is there anything that he's not worthy of in us demonstrating our love towards him? Because you know what? It didn't matter. It didn't matter if this oil was worth a year's wage. Both of these ladies said, I want to give that up and honor Christ. Both of them, I think, were aware that his death was coming. And they knew that the opportunity to honor him before he went was not going to be there. So they took these two opportunities to pour out their treasure upon the Lord. Why? Because of the gratitude and the love that they carried in their heart. 2 Corinthians 2:15 to 16 says, our lives are a Christ-like fragrance rising up to God. But this fragrance is perceived differently by those who are being saved and by those who are perishing. To those who are perishing, we are a dreadful smell of death and doom. But to those who are being saved, we are a life-giving perfume. And who is adequate for such a task as this? You know, it's a call to allow our lives to be poured out in love for the Lord. Our time, our treasure, our talent, our all. Society teaches us to hold everything back and just give a little bit. Society teaches us, you know, just a couple drops of oil in the water. Just a little drop of oil in the water. Not 12 ounces of pure salve dumped over the feet or the head of Christ. But you know what? Jesus loved and appreciated and received that sacrificial gift. And he commended her to the point that the woman who had anointed his head, he said, wherever the gospel is preached, her act will be remembered. Wherever my good news is proclaimed, people will remember what she did for me and her love for me and her sacrifice made for me. Church, I got to tell you, it really reflects back, because you know the Word of God is a mirror. And when you look at this, it really kind of mirrors back at our hearts and lets us see what's inside of my own heart. How extravagantly am I willing to love the Lord? How extravagantly am I willing to lay down my life and my comforts and my desires and the things that I want so I can honor Christ with my life? Maybe God is calling you to something that means that you have to let go of something else in order to do it. Maybe there's a sacrifice involved in holding fast a commitment to serving Jesus in some area of your life. But is it too extravagant? The world might say you're wasting yourself, you're wasting your time, you're wasting your energy. You could have made more money doing this, or you could have gotten this for that. But Jesus looks at it and says, I see that sacrifice, and it's not too extravagant. And I appreciate and honor when you come and lay that down before me. You see, we live in a society that tells us to get everything we can get. After all, the famous word on every commercial, on every reality TV show where someone's getting some blessing, the favorite word is, you deserve it. You know what we deserve? Life in hell. That's what we all deserve. And in our greed and our selfishness, if it was not redeemed by the blood of Jesus, we deserve life in hell. There is none worthy, no, not one, Scripture tells us. Romans, when Paul writes it, 3:10, there's none worthy, no, not one. We don't deserve any of it. But we spend our lives pursuing it, pursuing more of what we can have, more of what we want. You know, there have been seasons, I know, in my wife and I's life that we've been in hard places and we've ministered at hard places and through hard seasons, and we're like, and it's been so discouraging or so downcast without one. We could have done this, we could have done that. But you know what? It's like sometimes we go back because we used to sing that song that Steve Green wrote. I was actually humming it the other day in my office, and Kim's like, you're not going to sing that, are you? That's really old. And I'm like, no, I just wanted to hear it over again. But we used to sing it, Lord, let me be spilled out and used up for thee. Is there really anything that's too much of a sacrifice for Jesus? Because contrast that with the destruction of a greedy heart, which is my next thought. The destruction of a greedy heart. You got that, William? There you go. Because opposite the sacrificial outpouring of love is Judas. Mark's gospel account, 2 days, this is where we know, Judas has already festered for 4 days, mad that Mary had washed Jesus' feet with that oil and wiped it with his hair, and has already festered for 4 days, ticked off because he was trying to plot, how could I have gotten some of that money from that oil? Such a waste. And now it happens again. A second time. And what does he do? Right after this happens, he goes out. Mark 14 doesn't mention, it says some of the disciples were indignant. It doesn't mention them by name, but John 12 sure mentioned it was his voice that came up, and you can pretty much be rest assured it was his voice this next time as well, because right afterwards, he goes to the priest, and he sells out Jesus to betray him so he can get his 30 pieces of silver. You know what 30 pieces of silver bought? A slave. That's all Jesus was to him. Jesus was a slave to him. He was a means to get something that he wanted. How often do we treat Jesus, are we love slaves to Christ, or do we treat him like he's our slave? Jesus, I need to be healed. Jesus, I need money for this. Jesus, I want you to do this for me. Jesus, heal my marriage. Jesus, let me have another baby. Jesus, do this. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Cosmic vending machine Jesus. Here's a quarter. Give me something, Jesus. We treat Jesus like that all the time. Jesus, you're my slave. Do for me. And as soon as he's not, oh, sell that slave. He ain't no good. You're not getting me anything that I need anymore. Just get rid of him. Sell him 30 pieces of silver. And he goes and he sells the Lord. You know, what does Jesus end up doing in the long run? The guilt overwhelms him till where he commits suicide. The guilt and the shame of his selfishness brings him to a place of deep destruction. The fragrance in that room, to him it wasn't a fragrance of life. The fragrance in that room when that jar was opened up didn't speak to him about bringing a sacrificial love to the Lord and giving of himself to Christ and loving Jesus. He had been with him for 3 years. He'd heard everything he taught. He watched everybody he healed. He was a follower of Christ. And yet when it came down to it, the love of money became the root of all evil. His love for money would destroy him because he would completely miss the will and the plan of God to save mankind through the Passover lamb, which Jesus had told them. But it was more important what he could get rather than what he could give. He had not yielded himself to the lordship of Christ, and Christ calls him out on this. You know, Jeremiah 17, 9 to 10 says that the human heart is the most deceitful of all things and desperately wicked. Who really knows how bad it is? It's a pretty powerful statement. But I, the Lord, search all hearts and examine secret motives. I give all people their due rewards according to what their actions deserve. Man, Judas would experience what he deserved. The condemnation, the guilt, the shame that came on him was his own. He brought it on himself when he sold out the Messiah for the price of a slave because he didn't get what he wanted. Because by the second time this happened, he just wasn't having any of it anymore. Sacrificial love, a betraying heart. Same room, same fragrance, both followers of Christ. One leads to be honored for all of history. One leads to destruction and shame for all of history. So, what do we do with that? First of all, let us praise God for our Passover lamb who died to take away our sins. We see in hindsight what was still before them in that day. But we see two great acts of love that actually pointed to Jesus as being chosen to be the Lamb of God that Passover season. Chosen and anointed. These women, I don't really think that they understood just what they were doing and the significance of what it was. I do believe that in their love for the Spirit of God moved on their hearts and compelled them to demonstrate their love to Jesus because it would point for all of history towards the work of Christ. May our hearts be like those women with sacrificial love inside of them. May we want to extravagantly. You know, that's why sometimes we say, come on, church, let's praise the Lord this morning. We can come in and we can even hold back our own verbal praise. We can hold back clapping our hands. We can hold back raising our hands. When God says, bring extravagant praise. Halal praise is to praise him with all parts of your being, all that is within you, in your mind, your soul, your body, your spirit, to clap, to jump, to shout, to cry out, because it's extravagant praise poured out on the Lord. And when we come and we bring him our gifts, it's love poured out on the Lord. God doesn't, when you give your tithe, you're not paying a tax. You're expressing love to Jesus. And God knew way back when. He knew how much money has a hold on our hearts. Look at Judas. The love of money is the root of all evil. And sure, here's a tremendous example of that. But to these women, it was taking their most precious. They said that this could have been, for Mary, could have been a family heirloom that had been passed down for generations. It could have been something that was being kept for someone's burial. Its value. I mean, come on, think of it. I mean, $36,000, $40,000, an annual income of a common laborer. Even if that's just $25,000, that's still, you know, still in the range for a car. Just. Nothing too extravagant for him. Or are we going to be like Judas, who in his greed just couldn't even see the plan of God? Missed God's plan, missed God's lamb, the sacrifice. Jesus was about to die for Judas's sin, but he didn't live long enough to discover it. Before Jesus was crucified, or at the time he was, Judas took his own life, never to experience that forgiveness that Christ was paying for. What will we do? Where will our heart be? As Jesus was anointed for burial, there's a lesson for us to honor God extravagantly with our lives and not to have betraying hearts because of all the selfish desires we have in our lives, but to give extravagantly before him of ourselves and our love to the Lord. Would you bow your heads with me? Can we bring up the stage lights or the house lights? If you just play "Oh, the Wonderful Cross." This morning, I just feel like I need to open the altar for a few moments. Just as a place to come and kneel and pour out our love to Jesus. That's, if you've had an issue of betrayal in your heart, that's between you and God. My invitation today is to just be able to come and pour out love to the Lord in worship. So right now they're open. If you want to come and do that, just come and do that. I'm inviting you to come and say, "Jesus, I want to pour out my love to you today. Thank you, Jesus." Oh, when I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count but loss, and pour contempt on all my pride. There's more room here. Isn't there anyone else who want, who will come and just pour out their love for Jesus? Just come and just kneel at the front or stand at the front and just lift up your hands to God. I pour out my love for you today. You're not admitting to betraying Jesus. You're just saying, "God, I want to pour out my love. I want to give you my love. It's not about my pride." Listen to the words of the songs. "My richest gain I count but loss. I pour out my pride." Because it's about surrendering. It's about extravagantly loving Jesus. And the Bible tells us that he honors us when we do that. Oh, when I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died. Thank you, Jesus. My richest gain I count but loss, and pour contempt on all my pride. Oh, the wonderful cross, oh, the bids me come and die and find that I will truly live. Yes. Oh, the wonderful cross. Oh, the wonderful cross. All who gather here by grace, draw near and bless your name. Oh, the wonderful cross. Oh, the wonderful cross. that I may truly live. Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, the wonderful cross. Oh, the wonderful cross. All who gather here by grace draw near and bless your name.
Now, if you're here today, and if your heart, I'm not calling anybody a Judas today, but if inside your heart, if you feel that there's been selfishness, if inside of your spirit man, you know that you have placed other desires, other longings ahead of God's plan, if maybe the thought of others pouring out their love for Jesus builds a little resentment inside of you today, then I'm encouraging you right where you're at. I'm not going to make you come forward. I'm not going to make you have to like show yourself before anybody else. But right where you're at, right as your head is bowed, I want to encourage you to say, Jesus, forgive me. Jesus, forgive me. If I've been selfish, Lord, forgive me for my selfishness. Because, Lord, I want to have a heart like Mary and this woman who we don't even know her name. I want to have a heart like that, Lord, rather than a heart like Judas. I want the fragrance in the room to be a pleasing aroma that draws me to life in Christ, not causes me to resent it and run to destruction. Because I believe that there's some in this room today and God is saying, come on. I've been here for you. I've given my life for you. You're still so focused on all this other stuff. And Jesus is saying, I want you to discover the joy of being extravagant with your love to me. Extravagant with your praise and your worship and your life. And pouring out your life for me. Because you know, when we look to the cross and we see his sacrifice, it should bid us to come and bring the same to him. Jesus, I pray for those right now in this room that, Lord, you're knocking at their hearts, even those who are followers of you. Yes, Lord, those who are followers of you, but, Lord, their heart has had some areas that they've just kind of strayed in, areas where their own desires have gotten in the way of your desires. They've lost sight of your plan in their life. They've lost sight of those things because they've wanted the things of this world more than you. Jesus, it happens in our human frailty. But Lord, that's why you died for us. That's why I know, Lord, that had Judas lived through and seen the resurrected Savior, that you would have forgiven him, and Lord, that he would have been restored. But his own destruction, his own condemnation brought him down. Lord, may we surrender to you before our own condemnation brings us to destruction. You don't condemn us. You convict us, Lord, but you don't condemn us. We condemn ourselves when we feel the shame of our choices. But your Holy Spirit calls us to come and be forgiven and made whole. So right now I pray. Right now I pray in your people here in this room, in this church, that, Lord, we would yield our hearts. That the fragrance that fills the room is the fragrance of life. That it calls us to greater love and greater life and greater commitment to you. Jesus. Jesus. Just say his name, church. Jesus. Jesus. Oh, the wonderful cross. Oh, the wonderful cross bids me come and die and find that I will truly live. Oh, the oh, the wonderful
cross, all who gather here, by grace draw near and bless your name.
Lord, I pray over your people today, Jesus, as we go from this place today. Lord, this week may we stop and examine our hearts. And Lord, may we look for ways to extravagantly pour out our love to you. Jesus, help us to extravagantly pour out our love to you. Bless your people now as we go from this place. Lord, till we come back again, may your health and your safety, your provision be upon the lives of your children. For we ask it, say with me, church, in Jesus' name, amen. God bless you as you go.